We've all looked at the stars at night. Have you ever wondered if it's possible that there is a planet with extraterrestrial life in one of the countless stars that surrounded us, and that one of those aliens looks at our star asking the same question? Today, we know that most stars have exoplanets, that many of those exoplanets look a lot like Earth, and that a good portion of those exoplanets that look like Earth are in their star's habitable zone. We also know that if life formed on Earth, it's likely to have formed elsewhere in the universe, on some planet with similar conditions. Finally, we know that in our galaxy, the Milky Way, there are at least 100 billion stars, and that each star has approximately 3 planets. So, in our galaxy alone, there are at least 300 billion planets, of which at least a third could have conditions to host living beings. So if the odds of other intelligent civilizations out there are very high, where are they? Why haven't we found a single piece of evidence of extraterrestrial life to this day? Are we entirely alone in the universe? Keep watching to find out. Fermi paradox. This apparent contradiction between the high probability of finding advanced extraterrestrial life and the lack of evidence for the existence of such intelligent civilizations is known as the Fermi paradox. One of the most critical aspects of Fermi's paradox is the probability argument. It tells us that given the ability of intelligent life to overcome scarcity and its tendency to colonize new habitats, it seems possible that at least some civilizations are technologically advanced, seek new resources in space, and colonize their star system, and subsequently the surrounding star systems. Since there is no significant evidence of other intelligent life on Earth or anywhere else in the known universe after 13.8 billion years of the universe's history, there is a conflict that requires resolution. Some examples of possible solutions are that intelligent life is rarer than previously thought, that assumptions about intelligent species' overall development or behavior are wrong, or more radically, that the current scientific understanding of the nature of the universe itself is incomplete. As a result of this proposal, different solutions have been proposed to respond to the Fermi paradox. One of the first proposals was the famous Drake equation. This was an equation proposed by American scientist Frank Drake in 1961. In which he proposed a way to find the total number of intelligent civilizations that could exist in the universe based on the different factors involved in the existence of extraterrestrial life. These factors are N equals the number of civilizations in the Milky Way with which communication might be possible, i.e. those in the cone of light of the present past. R star equals the average rate of star formation in our galaxy. FP equals the fraction of stars that have planets. NE equals the average number of planets that could potentially host life. FL equals the fraction of planets that could host life and actually develop life at some point. FI equals the fraction of planets with life that develop intelligent life, civilizations. FC equals the fraction of civilizations that develop a technology that releases detectable signs of their existence in space. L equals the period during which such civilizations release detectable signals into space, resulting in the equation N equals R star FP NE FL FI FC L. The fundamental problem with the Drake equation is that the last four terms, FL, FI, FC, L, are completely unknown, which makes it impossible to make accurate statistical estimates of extraterrestrial life, and thus does not provide a solution to the Fermi paradox. Another possible solution is the Great Filter Theory. Great Filter Theory. The Great Filter, or Great Filter Hypothesis, is a proposal by researcher Robin Dale Hansen of the University of Oxford, who proposed that in the development of life in the earliest stages of a biogenesis to researching the highest levels of technological development, there is a barrier that makes detectable extraterrestrial life extremely rare. This hypothetical barrier is the Great Filter. This hypothesis would tell us that something must slow down or reduce the number of civilizations that develop to be as technologically advanced as humans. This threshold of probability, which could have existed in the past or after human extinction, could function as a barrier to the evolution of intelligent life or as a high probability of self-destruction. The main takeaway from this argument is that how much easier it was for life to evolve to the stage humanity is at today would mean that the great filter is something humanity will face in the future, and what will end our civilization, like a nuclear war. This would mean that all species that manage to develop nuclear weapons eventually end up self-destructing, which is why we haven't found them, because every time one reaches that degree of technological advancement, they end up annihilating each other, and human civilization could be next. Hey, before moving on, be sure to like or dislike the video so that we can improve them for you, the viewer. Plus, don't forget to subscribe to our channel by making sure to hit the notification bell so you don't miss any of our daily videos. The role of viruses in evolution. Although many scientists suspect that the great filter could be in the future, many others conjecture that this hypothetical great filter could be found in the past. How could this be? To understand this, we must consider everything that life has gone through to get where it is today. Some studies suggest that life on Earth could have emerged about 4 billion years ago, shortly after the Earth formed. This tells us that once all the conditions for the formation of life are present, it does not take long for it to appear. If life takes a long time to appear, then it would be subject to how long a star can remain on its primary sequence. But if life actually appears very soon after a planet forms, this could not be a great filter. In other words, the great filter would have to happen after the first living things appeared, perhaps in something that caused life to develop into what it is today. The answer could lie in viruses, no less. In nature, we can see that viruses are found practically everywhere. There is the virus of rabies, Ebola, smallpox, etc. All viruses have different characteristics, but if there's one thing they have in common, it is that although they share many similarities with living beings, such as the ability to replicate and evolve, they lack other vital characteristics, such as their metabolism and the ability to carry out independent cellular functions. That's why most scientists do not classify them as living beings. But if viruses are not living beings, then what are they? They are what they are, viruses. Organisms that look like living beings but are not. They attack living organisms, feed on them, and reproduce by taking advantage of the DNA strands of living beings. But curiously, they are not living beings. It seems that viruses are chemical organisms that evolved completely separate from living beings, and that, in a way, they are opposed to life since viruses can eradicate living beings. However, despite the fact that viruses are harmful and it seems that their only function is to destroy living beings, could it be that viruses are also the reason why the living beings of the planet have managed to develop so much? Think about it. Without viruses, the first microbes that appeared on the planet would not have had any threat. Nothing that would endanger them or force them to evolve very quickly. But when there was the threat of viruses, living beings had no choice but to evolve very quickly, so that viruses would not exterminate them. So the existence of viruses on Earth could be a viable solution to the great filter hypothesis. In this way, it would be possible that microbial life is prevalent in the universe. But without viruses, like those on Earth, these extraterrestrial life forms are not pressured to evolve quickly. Even if they manage to evolve due to changes in their environment, there is no guarantee that they will manage to develop to a certain degree of complexity, or that they will develop technologies like the ones we humans develop. But how possible is that viruses were the driving force behind the development of the enormous diversity of living beings on the planet? Some scientists think viruses introduced genetic information into living things in ways that could have helped shape the genomes of life on Earth. An example of this can be seen in humans, who, thanks to the various viruses that have hit us in pandemics, now have better defense against them. If this happened with all living things on the planet, it would mean that viruses somehow help the evolutionary process of the species. However, evolution can also benefit from mutations, which do not depend on viruses. This would imply that the absence of viruses should not be an obstacle to developing intelligent life on other planets. Or should it? Retroviruses and human development. A recent study by a group of scientists led by Tanay Ghosh of the Cambridge Labs Institute of Science investigated a substance called myelin and its importance in developing human intelligence. Myelin is a mixture of proteins and lipids necessary to insulate nerve axons. It resembles the insulator of an electrical wire, but is obviously much more important since it allows the electrical impulses of nerve cells to be up to 100 times faster. They also observed that the myelin coating makes neuronal fibers thinner and longer, allowing nervous systems such as those in the brain to be much more efficient in response speed and processing. So, evolutionary, a species with this protein would react faster to danger, could develop better hunting strategies, and would generally be more intelligent than those without. But what does the myelin have to do with viruses? The scientist in charge of the research discovered that at some point in history, a retrovirus infected vertebrates with jaws. In response, they activated the production of myelin, which helped defend against that virus. They helped them develop more complex and faster brains like humans. It seems that at some point in the past, during the development of the diversity of species that inhabit the planet, this virus infected different animals, activating myelin production in different animals around the world as a kind of convergent evolution. The interesting thing is that the person responsible for this was a retrovirus. Retroviruses are viruses composed of RNA and are characterized because they can make copies of their own DNA and embed that genetics in their host, passing that characteristic from generation to generation. This would mean that without this retrovirus, the human race would not have developed the intelligence and skills that led us to develop the great civilization we are today. It's interesting how today many viruses take the lives of thousands of human beings, such as smallpox, Ebola, or rabies. But if it were not for the existence of viruses, we would not be here. Could it be that on other exoplanets where life has developed, it never evolved into an intelligent species because viruses do not exist in that world? Is it possible that the great filter that prevents life from developing to the point the human race has is that our planet is the only one where viruses developed? We want to know what you think. Leave your opinion in the comments.